enough. I'm encouraged today. It seems like God has, through the songs and through the prayers,
yes,
that God has encouraged us with his own witness, his testimony. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelations that the enemy shall be defeated by the blood of the Lamb. In the word of our testimony, how do people know that God is real?
Yes.
Unless they see him and experience him in the world around them. We know that Romans chapter 1 tells us that God can be seen in his creation, and that the world is without excuse as it relates to believing that God exists. And oftentimes we take that to only mean in his nature. But it also means in us. We are his creation. We are, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, we are his workmanship.
Mm-hmm.
So the world can see not only through God's natural creation, but the world can see through us. We are living in a very divisive time in history.
Yes.
The political unrest is not just national, it's global.
Yes, right.
With some of the recent political activity in our country, it has caused somewhat of an uproar,
yes,
across the globe.
Amen.
And it has resulted in a lot of chaos,
yes,
and divisiveness, where people are divided,
yes,
countries are divided, races are divided, classes are divided, and the church is divided.
Amen.
Wow. The body of Christ, who Jesus prayed for in John 17, when he prayed to the Father, he says, I wish they would be one even as you and I are one. But this particular leader, who is now our president, who Romans 13 tells us to pray for, is clear. I knew it was coming. That's why I preached Romans 13 right at the Sunday after he won. I preached Romans 13. I know y'all didn't take notes. That's okay. What I'll do, because I have sermon notes on every sermon, I might just print it and sit it on the chair for you to take.
Amen.
Because the reality is that we have an obligation as it relates to political and governmental authority. We don't know all of God's purposes. All we see is someone that we perceive is unfit to lead us.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay.
And I'm not trying to step on the toes of any Republicans, because I thought about this as I prepared this message, and I thought about Barack Obama, and I honestly assessed my feelings about him, which were full of affirmation for who he was in his character. Because I didn't agree with all his politics.
Yeah, amen.
So if I were to be honest, it has nothing to do with the current leader identity. It has nothing to do with his politics, but I'm concerned about his character.
Yes.
So yes, he's the president. And yes, I have some definite feelings about that, but my greatest concern is his character. The previous president, aside from the fact that he was considered the first African-American president and can be said to kind of live somewhere on the left, he was also a man of great character. He did not bow down to all the attacks he experienced. He did not use his political office to wage personal wars. Did he have a political agenda? Yes. He did. Every president does. But it was not personal. It was what he perceived what was best for the nation. Our current president has some very glaring character defects. He appears, because I do not know him personally, to be rash, to think and act too quickly, and to not value the wisdom of those who came before him.
Amen.
Those are biblical concepts, to be patient, to seek wisdom in a multitude of counsel, to be slow to anger, quick to listen. Those are biblical characteristics. So my concern is for his lack of characteristics. But nevertheless, I have a greater concern, which is how divisive his leadership has been to the Christian church. The church is so divided.
Yes.
We already had many hurdles to overcome in the church as it related to class, the have and the have-nots, as it related to race, blacks and whites. We still say that Sunday morning is the most segregated hour in America. And when we say that, we're talking about how segregated, how separated the Christian church is. And I believe that the current leadership, the current administration, has further widened the gap.
Amen. Amen.
In the church, where we are even more divided. So, being a hopeless romantic and corny, I begin to sing this song, "What the World Needs Now." Don't worry, I sung it to myself. It's love, sweet love. It's the only thing there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No. Not just for some, but for everyone.
Yes.
This is a clarion call to the church.
Yes.
because we have to be careful to not overly identify with our allegiance in the world to the degree that they become more impactful than our allegiance to God. Let me say that again. We have to be careful that we don't over-identify with our allegiance in the world. We have allegiances to people, to political parties, to certain ways of thinking, to ideologies, philosophies. And I'm saying we have to be careful not to over-identify with these things, these allegiances, these relationships, because they're real, right? Whereby they become more impactful than our allegiance to God. Because God is love. So we start with the reality that the essence of God is love. Turn with me to John 13. If you have your Bibles, I want to read a few verses there, and then I just want to spend a few moments bringing out a couple of points that are displayed in verse 34 and 35. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Normally I preach from the NIV, but I want us to hear these words in this particular translation. John, the Gospel of John, chapter 13, I am going to read verse 31 through 35, where Jesus begins to have a conversation over several chapters about the end of his life and his death. But in this particular section, he's getting ready to talk about Peter's denial of him. Okay? It says here, as soon as Judas left the room, Jesus said, "The time has come for the Son of Man to enter into his glory, and God will be glorified because of him." He's talking about his death, burial, his resurrection, his ascension back into heaven. Okay? Where he'll sit on the right hand of God, and he will continue to play a role in our life because he'll make intercession for us.
Yeah.
So he'll still be working on our behalf as he relates to God the Father. That's good news. That Jesus didn't just die and leave it there, said, "I did all I could do for them. I'm out of here." But no, he sits at the right hand of the Father, still making intercession for us. That type of commitment. Verse 32, "And since God receives glory because of the Son, he will give his own glory to the Son, and he will do so at once." Listen, verse 33. "Dear children, dear saints of God, dear people of God, dear Christians, I will be with you only a little longer. And as I told the Jewish leaders, the religious folk, you will search for me, but you can't come where I'm going." Listen, verse 34. "So now I am giving you a new commandment."
Yes.
Now understand, Jesus did not come to rewrite the law, but he came to fulfill the law.
Yes.
Okay? He came to fulfill the law, but he says here, a new commandment I'm giving you, a new commandment. He says, love each other. Well, we heard that before, right? Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Mm-hmm. But here's the catch. A new commandment I'm giving you, love each other, watch this, just as I have loved you. So now it's different. It's not just love each other, but it's love each other the same way I've expressed love to you. This is deeper now. It's deeper. He says here, you should love each other. Verse 35, your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. It will show the world that you are Christians. It will show the world that you are followers of Jesus. It will show the world that God the Holy Spirit lives in us. It will show the world that Jesus is real. Three thoughts I want to give you today about this love. The first thought is, it is a new kind of love. Not new in the sense that it's new to God, but in the sense that it's new to us.
Yes.
To us living it out. And I'll get to that. Secondly, it is a sacrificial love. It is a new love, and it's a sacrificial love. It might cost all the way up to death.
Yes.
Might not, but it might. And don't think death in terms of just literally breathing your last breath, but sometimes it's death of my goals, death of my thoughts, death of what I want to do.
Yes.
How I want to act. How I want to think. I die to some of that, that I might display or express this love. Because if I hold on to everything I think or feel or act, sometimes I'm not gonna show this love, because sometimes I'm hotter than cayenne pepper.
Yes.
I'm hot. So it ain't gonna be about love. So some things I'm gonna have to die to express this love. And then lastly, it's a visible love. Three things, real quick. New kind of love, sacrificial love, visible love.
Yes.
New kind of love, sacrificial love, visible love. New kind of love, a new commandment. In the Old Testament, and we see in the laws of Moses in Leviticus 19:18, we see this first ideal of love going from humanity to humanity when he says, love your neighbor as yourself. Now that's loaded, because what if I don't love myself? What if I don't like myself? What if I'm constantly dogging myself? Then it, chances are I'm a dog other people. What if I see myself as unworthy or ugly or nothing special about me, then I'm gonna treat other people that way, right? That's a reality. Getting into just the psychology or the sociology or the reality of who we are. If I don't feel good about myself, chances are I'm going to hurt people, because hurt people hurt people.
Yeah.
But the love of God moves us from hurting people hurt people to wounded healers. So yes, I'm hurt and wounded, but the love of God is oozing out of me, and out of my pain, out of my hurt, I'm able to minister to people not because I can heal, but because I've been hurt, I can feel deeper about other people being hurt. Hello?
Yes.
So I can move from hurt people, to I can be a wounded healer. Yes. I'm wounded, but God can use me to heal others. Yes. Okay, y'all get that? So this new kind of love moves me from just loving others as I love myself to loving others as God or as Jesus has loved me. Wow. Jesus gave everything. So he's calling us to a new standard of love. He said, I'm getting ready to go. And I'm getting ready to express to you how I want to leave my legacy.
Yes.
How God has designed for the perpetuation of who I am and what I'm about. Uh-huh. It begins with your ability to love each other as I have loved you.
Amen.
That you would be committed to this new kind of love. This new kind of love is a sacrificial love because it's the same love that Jesus expressed to us. It's a sacrificial love. Listen to 1 John chapter 3, verse 16 through 18. Again, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. We know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us.
Yes.
Wow. We know. This is our bar. This is our measurement of what real love or biblical love look like. And remember, and I believe I've told this before, and now I have to live it out. Really, since Deborah's been sick for 8 years, when I was being prepared to marry her, I came across Ephesians chapter 5 at a Willie Richardson marriage and single seminar, and it said, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church. I said, time out. Like, I can't pull this off. I went to our pastor who was mentoring me at the time. He wasn't even a pastor then. He was working at the rescue mission and an assistant pastor at Zion Chapel where he currently is now. And I said, man, I don't know about this marriage thing. He said, what you mean? I said, man, I can't pull this off. He says, well, Henry, you're not Jesus. You grow into this. God develops you. And you get stronger and better at it. You don't just start off being able to just straight up die like Jesus.
Right.
And at the time, I think I had only been walking with the Lord. I don't even think it had been a good 3 years. But I'm like, I'm still young and fresh.
Yes,
I'm taking
right.
the word literal. And I'm like, I might as well just stay single. I can't put this off. So we might not be there as it relates to love each other as God loves us, but this is the bar. This is what we're striving for, to love all of humanity like Jesus loved us.
Yes.
Now, I didn't know that... I would fast forward beyond that 20 years later, and my wife would be sick for 8 straight years.
Yes.
I didn't know that my life would be totally altered. Her life would be totally altered, and love would have to be expressed
yes.
in a different type of sacrificial
yes.
way. Then it got real. What real long as she could do everything for for me, or she could do the things I needed her to do, and I could do the things she needed me to do to move to, I could really only do the things she needed me to do and try to do some of the things she was doing to keep things moving forward, because she can't do nowhere near what she used to do.
Yes.
You follow? But of course, that's my wife, so it's a little easier. God's saying, treat everyone that way.
Amen.
Get thick now, doesn't it?
Right.
So it's a sacrificial love. Verse 16, we know what real love is because Jesus gave up his life for us, so we also ought to give up our lives for our brothers and sisters. If someone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need but shows no compassion, how can God's love be in that person? Dear children, let's not merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our action. So God, through Jesus, when Jesus say, love one another as I have loved you also one another, by this the world may know. So he's saying this love has to be an action verb. It can't be a warm hug on Sunday morning, love your brother or sister, be praying for you while you catch hell the other 6 days of the week. Catch you next Sunday, and I got a hug for you again next Sunday. But don't be bothering me Monday through Saturday. So he's calling us into a deeper commitment to him and to one another. And not just one another as it relates to one another. It's not just in this local fellowship. The one another is in the body of Christ.
Yes.
Because in John 13, he's saying, by this men will know that you are my disciples. So he's talking to his body. Here in 1 John chapter 3, he uses the term your brothers and your sisters. He's talking about the body of Christ. The people of God, the children of God, however you want to say it. So this love brings us to a death sometime and a deep commitment that might hurt and that might cost us something. It might cost. And then lastly, it's visible. He says, let us show the truth by our actions. So a new commandment, a sacrificial love, and a visible love. The implications is such that this love will be visible, observable, measurable, and experiential. It'll be visible. You can see it. Observable, you can witness it. Measurable, you can measure the intensity of it, the realness of it. Experiential, you can engage it and experience it. You can feel it and say, wow, this person really loves me. I hope you say that about your pastor. I hope you say, man, that cat really loves me.
Amen.
Because a biblical love should be visible, observable, measurable, and experiential. And God communicated this to us in John 15:13 when he says there's no greater. So he measured the love. He says no greater love. He measured the love.
Yes.
So it's empirical evidence of the love. It can be measured. He says no greater love than this. But that a man would lay down his life for his friends. Jesus said.